prends le micro. Ouais.
Très bien, donc bonjour tout le monde. Donc c'est toujours avec plaisir et un immense intérêt qu'on accueille Guy Pujol. Donc je pense que il est inutile de le présenter, mais bon, la tradition veut qu'on touche quand même deux trois petits mots. Guy, comme vous le savez, est prof au Lipsis. Il travaille sur des problématiques réseau et donc aujourd'hui il va nous présenter une approche synoptique et avec une certaine hauteur de vue du cloud computing, en particulier appliqué au mobile. Comme vous voyez, il y a un certain nombre de logos, notamment des activités complémentaires de Guy, qui participent de manière active au développement d'activités, de recherche qui trouvent leur application dans l'industrie en France, notamment au travers d'un certain nombre de start-up. Voilà. Donc je te laisse la parole je pense que nous allons tous apprécier cette présentation autour du cloud computing, en particulier appliqué au mobile. Merci.
Merci beaucoup. Premièrement, quelle est la langue? C'est français ou anglais?
Coréen?
Moi, c'est comme vous voulez, moi.
Coréen, c'est possible?
Ah, coréen, non. Non, mais sérieusement.
En français, c'est parfait, comme ça, on en sera bon. Plus. Voilà. Merci.
Donc, en anglais. OK, so thank you very much for this invitation. I'm very happy to be here, as usual. In Tunisia, so I'm here to present a field that is very important today. It's mobile cloud computing. I'm going to have an idea, present an idea of what is this mobile cloud computing, and I will enter more in detail to present an architecture that could be used for mobile cloud computing. So first of all, it's important to notice that there is no clear definition about mobile cloud computing. It's not so clear. There is different potential definition of that, and mainly there are two points important. Could be as a main goal application oriented or network oriented. So if it's application-oriented, the idea is to allow a mobile device with limited resource to process computational intensive applications. And if it's network-oriented, the idea is to optimize the different control schemes for mobile services. So it's really different. But you may have in the same time both environments, so optimize services and optimize network-oriented services. So let us have some example about that. If it's application-oriented, generally we talk about rich mobile applications. So rich mean that you need a lot of computation. And this computation cannot be realized on the mobile itself, but will be realized in the cloud, so outside the mobile. So for example, for gaming, we are talking about mobile cloud gaming, or now it's more mobile cloud as a service. This could be an application of a mobile cloud. And the need for the power is not at all sufficient in the mobile terminal, mobile device. So you ask a cloud somewhere in the world to do the work, and there is just a communication between the mobile and the cloud. Another example is augmented reality. Another example is about computation-intensive mobile application. Again, it's optical character recognition. For example, you need a lot of power in the CPU, and this cannot be realized on the terminal itself. and also natural language processing. Now, if we're talking about network-oriented technology, we have a firewall, for example. I will give an example on that. The firewall is not in the terminal, but it's in the cloud somewhere. It could be a huge cloud or a small cloud, depends. We have another application, for example, with handover control. The handover can be decided by the device itself, the mobile device. But now we are going also to see that more in detail. We need a lot of information about the antenna, about the different networks that can access, and so on. So this cannot be handled by the terminal itself. And it could be much better to do that outside the terminal in a small cloud, what we can name this cloudlet, instead to be in the device. And same thing, for example, for mobile device attachment. If I may have different type of attachment, a 3G, 4G attachment, a Wi-Fi attachment, or WiMAX, how to decide what's the best. And this, again, need a lot of computation if we take into account a large number of information. So again, this can be realized outside the terminal, the device, in a cloud. So currently, we have a different proposal. So I just have four, but it's a small proposal, in fact, that it's not general. And what I will do in this talk is to propose a more general architecture. So let us begin by some example of architecture. The first one is a cloud for mobile terminals. That's very classical. It's like for a fixed terminal, in fact. You have a lot of work to do in the terminal, and you push this work in the cloud, so in the data center somewhere. So the terminal, in fact, is the thin client that is connected remotely on the cloud. Another proposal in the literature is a local cloud computing provider. In that case, we have the association of several terminals, several devices, plus a small cloud that is closed from the different terminals, from the different devices. And this cloud, so it's a small cloud, the name could be sometimes micro cloud, it could be a nano cloud, or even pico cloud. And using so small data centers, these small data centers could be in the DSLAM, so not far from the user, could be in an access router, could be in a home gateway, so very close from the terminal itself. Another example that also in the literature is what we name the virtual cloud computing provider. So in that case, the mobile is not using only one data center in one cloud, but in fact, different clouds. And there is a first machine, that this first machine is here, that selects what is the good cloud for the service of that has to be on the terminal itself. So sometimes we can say it's a sky provider, and the first machine chooses what is the best cloud to take care of the service. A last one that is important, but it's more for network-oriented application, it's what we need, cloudlet. So it's small cloud, again, it's a small cloud close from the terminal, and the terminal use this small cloud, for example, again, to decide about handover. But as the mobile is moving, the association with the data center change. So at some point, have the direction from the mobile, it's to a new cloudlet. And the idea is to be very close from the terminal so that the round trip to decide something is very small. For example, if you want to decide about a handover, you cannot wait for a long time. So it's necessary that the decision is very rapid, and it's necessary in that case that the cloud where the computation is realized be very close from the terminal. So I have to change the cloud I'm using depending on where I am. And this is generally for small and dense area, for example, in the town. Okay, so now we can try from this different example to see what could be a general technology for mobile cloud architecture. And what we would like to have, it's in the same time to have application and network application oriented. So we would like to have, in the same time, improve the performance and reliability for mobile application, but also all services for the network itself, so performance of mobile network control application, minimization of energy consumption, this is very important, availability, and also a very important point is security, because all is mobile and all is virtualized, as we are going to look at, and the security is really important. And obviously, security is also important for m-commerce, m-cloud access, m-payment, etc. So the security has to be part of this architecture. So the architecture that we can propose to try to have a global view on mobile cloud architecture need to have, in the same time, a cloud, so data center, and small cloudlets. We need to have, in the same time, as I said, security. And the view we have now about security is the cloud of security. It's a really new environment I'm going to describe at the end of this talk. We need also the new function that are very important virtualization. It's network virtualization function, NVF. And that is more and more used for mobile cloud architecture. And finally, we need VM migration, so virtual machine migration. That's all the technology we need to have a nice architecture for mobile cloud. So I will begin by this NVF, network virtualization function. That is really also a new thing under normalization currently, and it's changing the panorama. So let us have a look first, what is virtualization? Because all will be virtualized in 10 years. All network equipment, if we're looking at server, currently we have, say, something like 65% of the server are virtualized. But in networking, it's maybe 1% only. And in the next 10 years, all network equipment will be virtualized. So what is virtualization exactly? Take, for example, a router. So this is a physical machine. How to virtualize this machine? First of all, we can have a code that is describing exactly what is doing the physical machine. So now I have my virtual router. The virtual router is a software describing exactly what is doing the physical machine. What I can do with this software? Because if I execute this software on a processor that is in the router, the performance will be very, very low. Maybe I have to divide the performance by a factor of 1,000. So it seems not very interesting. But if you put this software on a huge machine, assume 1,000 more powerful than the router at the beginning, you have the same performance. So now I have a code that is executed in this new machine, much powerful than the first router. And I have a virtual router inside. It's the software with the same performance. But if I increase the power of my machine here by, again, a factor of 1,000, I have now a router that is 1,000 more powerful than the first machine. So you can see that depending on what you want to do, you can increase or decrease the size of your router. So that's very important for the future, because if there is no work to do, you can decrease the power of the virtual machine and you have a small router. And if at some point you have a lot of flows going through the router, you can increase the performance of the router. So the router is still exactly the good size in comparison with the flows he has to treat. But where are these different machines? In a data center. So now, in the network world, all the network equipment will be in data centers. So it's why it's so important to have huge data center or even small data center. It depends what I want to do. But you need a lot of machine like this where all the physical machine will be transferred, but not in physical, in software, so virtual machine. So this center could be very huge. If you are looking at the biggest data center currently, it's Google, somewhere in the United States, and it's 1 million machine in the same data center, 1 million machine. And Google has approximately 25 data centers like this. But another problem is the fact that this consumes a lot. If we're looking just at one data center, it's approximately 100 megawatts. And if there is 25, it's 25 dots multiplied by 100. So it's 2.5 gigawatts. And just to have an idea, if you are looking at a nuclear plant is 1 gigawatt. So just for Google, you need 2.5 nuclear plants just for the electricity for the data center. And Google is not the only. You have a lot of Amazon, Microsoft, and so on and so on. So you look that the energy is really important in this new environment. But it's clear that the future of the network is this. All the network equipment will be in data centers. It's finished all the room where you have a lot of physical machine. No, that's finished. Now it's in data center and virtualization. Okay, now we can virtualize all what we want. It's sufficient to describe the machine into a software. So sometimes it's not possible. For example, an antenna. An antenna receives a signal, so you cannot virtualize an antenna. Sometimes you cannot also virtualize, for example, a sensor, because if you take the temperature, that's not software. It's really something hard. So sometimes you cannot virtualize all the things, but in fact, you can virtualize practically all machine and networking machine. So some example, for example, for firewall, that's not a problem to virtualize firewall because it's just software. You are looking at the flows, looking what could happen, what is if it's correct or not, depending on the RFC. So a virtualization of a firewall is really simple. You can, for example, again, another example is VLR, HLR, that also could be virtualized. It's clear that operators don't like very much, but it's not a problem. For example, Huawei and some other companies have a virtual VLR. You can virtualize a Wi-Fi access point. Seems curious because you have antenna, but you can virtualize the software. So inside the access point, the virtual access point, you have obviously a machine, that look like to a classical Wi-Fi access point, but inside you have an hypervisor, and you have 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 virtual machine that take care of different operators, for example, and each virtual machine could be totally independent of the other one. You can virtualize key, and this is also in 10 years, all the keys will be virtualized. So you will open your door at your house or of your car with your smartphone or with another card. So the key will be just a software. Again, your routers, switch, LSR, all these kind of things could be virtualized. So all will be virtualized in 10 years. Another view of virtualization is that one. So we need a network equipment hardware, that's clear. But now the advantage of data center, that's there is no specialization of the hardware. So you may have the same hardware and millions of copies. Then the hardware is not at all expensive. It's what we name now the free hardware. And so you may have millions of machine. And then what is important is the different virtual machine on this hardware. So we need an hypervisor. It could be Xen, could be VMware. There are a lot of different now hypervisor. And on over this hypervisor, we have a network operating system, and we have different networks, for example. So very important things in this field is the normalization of this, what we name network virtualization function. We have to know that virtualization is with an S and not a Z. There is a lot of discussion about that, but and finally, virtualization is a good way to write virtualization with an S. What is virtualization? Network virtualization function is in fact equipment. How to have a router that is the same router, a virtual router for everybody. This is normalized currently. And so not only a router, but all the machine and networking are being virtualized. And again, one of the advantage, there is compatibility on all the virtual machine, and you can increase the size, decrease the size, and so on. So this virtualization is very important for the success of virtualization of the networking machine. So what is the virtual network, in fact? And the virtual network, it's some data centers, and this is the white part of this figure. This is the data centers, and inside the data centers, you have different virtual machine. So if it's a router, for example, you have the blue network, and the blue network is IPv4, for example, network for, I don't know, a specific application. I may have another red network with a high security, for example, and I can have a green one that is doing video on demand, and so on and so on. So I can increase the number of virtual networks as much as I want, as many as I want, because it's just the space on the physical machine that is the restriction of the number of virtual networks. And we tried to have one network per user. Why not? When a user is so a mobile is connecting to the network, I can create a specific network for this mobile. The problem is it's not scalable today because we need billions of networks. Why not? So when I would like to access my bank, I can create my own network to access my bank with a good software for that, so with high security and so on. So it's not scalable today. So the idea is more to have 10, 20, 50 different virtual networks. What I can do, I can move, obviously, the software, because it's software, it's not the hardware. So I can move a machine. So if I have some problem on this physical machine, for any reason, I can move, again, this router, this red router from that point to this other point. And then I have just to change the routing table or the forwarding table to have a new network. So that's also another possibility, create, release, move all the machine in the different data centers. But now you can add not only the classical router switch, but you may add in this data center all the machine you need for your service or the control. So we may have a firewall, Wi-Fi access point, a VLR, HLR, SIP server, and so on and so on. So it's easy to have all the machine you want for a network. Now, one of the difficulty on what we're working today is what we name the urbanization. What is urbanization? Is where to place the different virtual machine to optimize the global view of the system. That's a very crucial problem today, and it's a very difficult problem because it depends the criteria you want to optimize. If you want to optimize, for example, performance, it's clear that you have to share the different physical machine with the virtual machine. But if you want to optimize energy consumption, for example, it's much better to have all your virtual machine on the same physical machine and to turn off all the machines that are not used. Because as I told you, there is so many machines in the world that we increase so much the energy consumption that we need to turn off as soon as necessary the machine that is not useful. So it's much better to group all the virtual machine on the same physical machine. So this is totally a big change where we learn about load sharing. It's finished, load sharing. Now it's the contrary. You have to have machines that are well loaded, and all the difficulty is to open a new virtual machine as soon as necessary. Okay, so urbanization is something like this. So to optimize one criteria that can be cost, that can be performance, that can be energy consumption, reliability, resilience, and so on and so on, you have to move your virtual machine for this optimization. And as the user are moving with the terminal, you have to move the virtual machine at any time for the optimization. Okay, some example of what we can do today. Assume that you have a terminal, so you want to access the cloud with your device, a smartphone, for example, and you are moving in the world somewhere, in Patagonia, for example, the south of Argentina or Chile, and I connect a small box that is on the right of this figure at the cloud through the Wi-Fi. And what I'm going to do in this box, I can move, I'm here, for example, in the hotel, and I can move a virtual Wi-Fi access point. What is this Wi-Fi access point? Could be the Wi-Fi access point in my office. And now I have it, my access point in my hotel in Patagonia. I can move also if I need a firewall, for example. So I move, I migrate this firewall in my box. And maybe I have another person in the room just close to me. I don't know. An American, for example, that is registered with AT&T, and for him, I can migrate, for example, an AT&T Wi-Fi access point so that he's connected on this classical Wi-Fi from AT&T. And again, I can move for him a firewall and an application somewhere. So this depends. The virtual machine for the application, so it depends if it's much better to have it close, or it's much better to have this application, this virtual machine in the cloud itself somewhere in the world. So it depends. So in this example, I move one virtual machine, but I can let this virtual machine in the cloud itself. So So that's the first example. So you can see you move Wi-Fi access point. So you are still in your office or at home, because if it's your virtual access point you have at home, it's the same one. So you're working like at home or in your office. And you can add, I don't know, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 virtual access points. This depends on your machine. So one of my startup is doing this, and this is small machine I can have in my pocket. Today is a little bit heavy, but again, in some years, it will be very small. And in this small machine, I may have 100 virtual machines inside and 8 virtual access points. So I can, as soon as an operator has an access point, I can recover the access point, and a lot of people can be connected on. So maybe in the long term, the hotel itself will have directly this box. It's not necessary to have you or in your pocket. This kind of bot will be everywhere. And as soon as there is a client going from Australia, who has an operator in Australia, I can recover the access point of the operator, Australian operator. This is the first example. Another example, important for a smartphone, is a firewall, because there is more and more attacks on a smartphone, and the firewall we have in the smartphone is not really resistant, and the power is too small. So the idea is to visualize the firewall. And then, when you have an access to your smartphone, that could be if you are, for example, have an access to the cloud, the flow that is arriving to your smartphone is sent to the virtual access point. So, what access point? The access point associated with the service. So you may have a firewall for each different application. So instead to have just one firewall that is doing something, but today not really a lot of things, you can just send the flows to the good and strong virtual firewall. If now I try to summarize all what I said, is the future of networking is data centers. So all the machine that you need in networking will be in data centers. It's a virtual machine, could be a router, switch, but also firewall, authentication server, and any kind of machine. And this is normalized until the NVF function. And one of the difficult part is to optimize the placement of this virtual machine between the big data center and the small data centers that are arriving on the market, so the cloudlets. And this is the problem of urbanization. And that's a really difficult problem, because you have to move all these virtual machines all the time. So one important thing, another example I have here, that on what we are working, it's a firewall that is turning 24 hours the world. Why? Because the cost is the best in the night. My firewall is still in the night and working from one data center to another one following the night. And it's why currently in the internet, the traffic is 80% in one direction and 20% only in the other direction, because we are all following the night more and more. So VM migration, what we need, if a mobile is moving, I will use this cloudlet, so I have to move all my virtual machine to follow the terminal, or for optimization of the placement of the virtual machine. And we have a lot of new protocols arriving at IETF, and that's also a huge problem. What's the best? And as we're going to look at, these things also is moving, is changing a lot, and we have a distribution finished. Now all is centralized. So the a classical protocol you know will be changed into a centralized protocol. So there is a lot of proposal today. So VXLAN is important, for example. It's an extension of VLAN. 11AQ, it's Ethernet carrier grade. MPLS is still important, but you have new protocols that are moving high up. Trill, for example, Lisp, OpenFlow are the new protocols that are now used to move this virtual machine and also obviously to take care of the flows of the user. So there is a lot of work also to do on this different protocols, what the best, in what condition, and so on. So I have two slides I'm going to pass. And to come here, in one of the most important moves we have today in networking is SDN. SDN is software-defined networking. What's the meaning of this? It's the fact that you decouple in a router, for example, the forwarding part and the control part of the router. So now the control part is no longer in the router, but is pushed outside the router in a controller or a virtualized controller in the cloud. And this is centralization, in fact, because we centralize all the control in one machine. And the name of this machine is a controller, but the controller will be virtualized. So the most well-known technology with SDN is OpenFlow, but decreasing a lot currently because you have a lot of new protocols, new approach, for example, in Cisco. So what is OpenFlow? It's a technology that is used using a controller. So when you access by a fixed or now more and more a smartphone, in the internet or in the network, you send the beginning of the flow. So the first packet of the flow is arriving in the router, and then this packet is sent to the controller, so to the center, and the center will compute the path to go to the destination. So the algorithm now is centralized, and the choice of the routing is decided in a centralized way. So why? Because what we would like to have in OpenFlow, but in the next future, not only OpenFlow, but in the next future, is to have one pass per user again. So today you have when you have a routing table or a switching table, it's the same for everybody. So maybe sometimes you may have 1, 2, 3 different table if you have 1, 2, 3 priority. But the idea for the future is to have one pass per user again. So what is you decide the route when you when you send your first packet. The first packet is sent to the controller, and the controller decides the route of the different packet of the user. So this route will depend on what would like to have the user. If he wants high performance, maybe I will try to get the shortest path. But if he want to optimize the energy consumption, it could be a totally different path. If I want to optimize the reliability of the path, it could be again another path. And if you mix the different criteria, you have a path to compute that could be totally different from all the other users. So the idea for the future is to have one pass per user, and not the in your routing table you have one routing table per user. And to do that, it's totally impossible to do that in a distributed way, because it's a lot of traffic. The only machine that could do that again is data center. So in data center you have so much power. You have so much memory, capacity, storage, that you can do that. You can store billions of routing tables. You can do that in a router, classical router. So we push currently we are going to that direction. All is centralized. So what is the network with the access to the cloud from a mobile. You have the mobile here. The mobile is connected to the network through a small box, and we can say it's a cloud-led box, because in this cloud, small cloud, you may recover a Wi-Fi access point or different virtual machine for your application. Then we have what we name today the Session Border Controller. What is the idea of the Session Border Controller? Is to retrieve the different profile of the user. Why? Because the user is connected on the Session Border Controller to be, for example, authenticated. And then at that time, as soon as I know the user, I know the profile, and I have a very precise idea of what would like to have the user. I have the SLA, but I may have other criteria that, like, again, is this user would like to have energy, the energy consumption, if it's, you want to have an optimization or not, if we would like to have a real time or not, if you would like to have reliability or not, security or not, and so on and so on. So the Session Border Controller have a good idea of the user. And then after this Session Border Controller is sending all the profile to the SDN controller in the cloud. So this is in a huge data center, and there I can compute one table per user. So that's the new view of the network today. So you can see it's totally different of what we saw until now. We had a decentralized network. Now it's totally centralized. Maybe in 10 years we will decentralize all the things. That's clear. So it's a good news for us, because it's a good news because we have a lot of work to do and to decentralize all what we're centralizing today. So the view of networking today, this, you have the smartphone more and more, or mobile terminal, or tablet, and then you access a first machine, a small cloudlet that could decide of different things, and recover your virtual Wi-Fi access point, your virtual machine. You have then in the cloud the border controller, for the acquisition of profiles, and then you send this to the global SDN controller. And if you're looking, for example, again, Cisco boot Meraki for 1.3 billion. What is doing Meraki? Meraki is doing something like this. He's working on this acquisition of profile, and this profile of the user is sent to the controller of Cisco. And the controllers of Cisco now, they have a new architecture, 1PK, and that is a concurrent of OpenFlow, that permits, again, to compute one routing table per user if necessary. Okay, it's not the case today. We compute a lot of different paths, not one pass per user, but in the next future, we will have one pass per user. Okay, so to finish my talk, just some words about security, because it's so important now with all these machines that are moving. As you can see, we have this virtual machine moving all the time. You have the user that is moving today, it is also moving, so we need to secure this. And there is also an enormous change today on that. So what's the idea? The main idea is to have a secure element. This secure element is there. It could be a SIM card or something like this. It's a hardware, because to have a high security, you need a hardware. You can have a security with software, but it's today it's really difficult to have high security with software, because we have so poor data centers that we increase by a factor of 4, 5, 6, 7 the possibility to decrypt an algorithm, because these data centers are so strong that the hackers today are able to crack a lot of things. So we need really hardware. So for a long time, for this, say 10 last year, we were based on this hardware. So this hardware could be the SIM card of the operator, could be a TPM, a trusted platform module, could be also embedded in the SD card, could be a secure microcontroller. And if we're looking really the smartphone, you can see that a lot of manufacturers like Samsung, Google, Apple, they have an embedded SIM inside the machine. Why? But just at the beginning to replace the SIM card of the operator. That was the idea. And one of the idea of Apple, for example, is at some point to say, hey, I am the operator now. And what to do for that? When you buy your machine, in the same time, you can say, wow, why not? Why not to be have Apple as an operator, as a telecom operator? But now Apple will work with its own SIM card, this embedded SIM card, and said to another operator, that could be T-Mobile or AT&T or the United States, for example, to say, oh, now you take care of the of this machine, and but the SIM card is my SIM card. And what the idea is to take 10% of all the application, or 10, 3, or 4, 5, depends, but a part of the price of the application. You may have also an external NFC card, near field communication. That's another possibility. So you see that there is a big fight today. Who is taking care of ID of the user? Currently, it's more the telecom operator, but could be the manufacturers, could be an application, an external application with an NFC card, and. Okay, and there is a new that would like to do that also, Google again. So with the first solution I mentioned, classically we have something like this. We have this famous secure element somewhere in your smartphone. You can open with the merchant an SSL connection with encryption, authentication, and so on. So you have a very strong authentication, and then using, for example, NFC, near field communication, the communication can continue between the smartphone and the cloud. That's the way we were thinking. And it's why, for example, Google bought Motorola several years ago, because Google had the idea that you need to be in the smartphone because the secure element is in the smartphone. But Google totally changed its view. Why? Because it did not succeed at all in Motorola. So he resell Motorola, and he decided to change the things. And the change is in the KitKat technology. KitKat is Android 4.4. It's a new Android technology. And it's totally different for security reason. So, if we're looking at the software key, because one of the idea is to replace the SIM card hardware by a software. So the solution, it seems at the beginning that the solution could be, okay, there is no SIM card in your smartphone, and now the SIM card is a software. So it's a virtual SIM card. But that's not possible. That's not possible because the security of the software is not at all the same as the hardware. So what was decided by Google is to externalize the SIM card. And now the SIM card is no longer in your phone, in your smartphone, but it's somewhere in the cloud. And this is the name of the cloud of security. So the SIM card is, if it's your Visa card, for example, the SIM card associated with the Visa card is somewhere in the in the bank, in the safe box in the bank. It's not necessary to have it in your pocket. The Visa card can stay in the bank, and when you want to buy something, in fact, you have a connection through the Android to your SIM card that is somewhere in the cloud of security, and this SIM card open the conversation between your SIM card and the cloud, And then after, when you have this authentication, you give back the hand to the terminal, and then you can continue to recover, for example, the movie or the music and so on. So if we look at the solution before KitKat, so Android 4.4, the SIM card is inside the smartphone. So in fact, for example, if you have an NFC reader, you have automatically in the Android before 4.4 a connection with the secure elements. So with the SIM card of the operator or with a SIM embedded SIM card of the manufacturers. But if we're looking at a KitKat, it's no longer possible. So Android 4.4 has no connection with the secure elements. So we go directly through the phone, and then the SIM card is outside, is in the cloud of security. What is the advantage? Is the fact that you may have not just one SIM card, but you may have a lot of SIM cards. You may have thousands, depending on what you are doing. If you are banking or buying something or paying for your at the restaurant, you may have different SIM cards. So a KitKat permits to send your request to the good SIM card. And then this SIM card is connected to the cloud, and then after you give back the end to the terminal, and then you can finalize the communication. It's what we name the host-based card emulation. So you can see that it's really something totally new. You remove the SIM card or the secure element from the smartphone, and you push this outside in the cloud of security. And this is a new way that the bank are thinking, finally, is to keep their own card, the Visa, Smart, or all other kind of cards, in there, in the bank itself. And you have just a proxy in your phone with KitKat, and then you, when you want to pay something, you have just a direction to the bank that take care of the payment. The main difficulty of that is the fact you have to be connected all the time. If you are not connected, you have no access to your SIM card. That's the problem. So personally, I'm not sure it's a good solution, but it's a solution that is pushed by Google, because they do not success in Motorola and in taking the power in this smartphone. So as it did not succeed, it decided, because they have 80% of the market with Android, so it decided to push the security outside. So we have a lot of example of that. For example, the virtual key to open a door, for example, an hotel door or the door of your car, instead to have it in your phone, and the smart card to secure the access is now in the cloud of security. Again, the difficulty for me, but it's why it's the future, your smartphone has to be connected all the time. And if your smartphone has a problem, a failure, that's a problem. You need to have something to open your door in that case. So you need the smartphone of somebody else. But again, it's not a problem if you use the smartphone of somebody else, because the secure element is not in the phone. It's outside. Okay, we have also all the problem of the securitization of virtual machine. So again, what is proposed by Google and some others is to have a smart card associated with virtual machine. So like your mobile terminal has a smart card, a virtual machine will have a smart card associated. So if the virtual machine is moving, for example here, the smart card is still authenticating the firewall, for example. So associated to each virtual machine, you have a smart card. Again, in the cloud of security. So as a conclusion, we can see that if we're looking at mobile cloud computing, the vision we have, and that is total virtualization, centralization in data centers that could be really centralized, a big, a huge cloud, a huge data center, or in cloudlet, so locally, to take care of the real time. We need this virtualization of virtual machine through the NVF standardization. We need VM migration to optimize the different criteria like performance, like cost, like energy consumption. So this is the four main points we have to take care for mobile cloud computing, and this is becoming a reality. We need maybe something like 5-10 years. And in 5-10 years, we begin to decentralize all this. So we have a lot of work to do. And why decentralization? Because we will have a huge power in the smartphone in 10 years. Instead to have 2, 3, 4 processor, we will have 100 processor in your smartphone, and we will have big memory. We have a small cloudlet in the phone in 10 years, and all these kind of things will be decentralized. But currently, for the next 5 years, centralization. So it's totally different from the past. Thank you very much, and I hope that you have a lot of questions.
Okay, thank you, Guy, for this presentation, this projection to our next future. I think we have time for some questions, and even if we don't, we'll take some questions.
So I have to thank you for this great talk. I really appreciate it. So since I have a basic knowledge about the cloud computing, I want to ask if the SDN controller can be virtualized and urbanized.
Absolutely, the SDN controller will be virtualized somewhere in a data center, in the cloud, in the data center, absolutely.
And it can be it can migrate from place to another equipment?
Absolutely, the SDN controller can migrate from one data center to another one if necessary.
Just another question. So there is no dependency between the users and this controller because it have the, I think that the border, the session border equipment will retrieve the user profiles and they will, after communicated it to the SDN controller. So I think that the migration of this point will depend maybe on the user?
No, should not depend really on the user. So if you migrate the SDN controller, it's to optimize something. And this has to be independent of the user. So the border controller really depends on the user, but the global SDN controller, there is no necessity to have a dependence of the user. But I agree that all the difficulties to continue to know where is the controller and why you move the controller. So if really there is a lot of work to do to move a controller, you have to take care. So sometimes it's a good idea to move a virtual machine. For example, if you are looking at what we name a big data, for example, big data, it's difficult to move a big data. It's a lot of work. But move a router is very easy because, in fact, you don't move the router itself because the software of the router could be directly in the other data center. So you move just the image, so the configuration of the router. And the configuration is just a few kilo octets. So it could be a router could be moved in less than 1 microsecond if necessary in the future. But to move big data, for example, it's a long time. So to move an SDN controller depends what you have to move. If it's a lot of data, it could be difficult and could be much better to let your controller in the same point.
Yes.
So that's also depends.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, sir, for presentation. Just two little questions. The first one, you have talked about the cloudlet in the slums and smartphones. So the term cloudlet is no longer related to the machine servers. How can we have a cloudlet in a DSLAM, for example?
A cloudlet in a small machine?
Yes, in the smartphone. You have talked that maybe in the future we will have cloudlet integrated to the smartphone. So how?
But for me, the definition of cloudlet is a small cloud. It's a small data center, in fact. A small data center. So it depends what you are meaning with cloudlet. But the new definition that generally we give in cloud networking, it's a small data center. So why not have a small data center in your smartphone? What is a data center? It's just power. So now we have not so powerful smartphone, but in 10 years, when we're looking at the development of processors today, I'm pretty sure that in 10 years we will have 100 processors, maybe 1,000 processors in your smartphone, and maybe, I don't know how many giga or terabytes in your smartphone. So it's like a small data centers, and it's what I name cloudlet in that
okay.
case.
Okay, thank you. Just a second question, please. I see here that for the research area, we are already in the phase of manufacturing and production. We already see Cisco and Google, etc. So for research about the cloud, the future, the current access, are there the transport protocol or maybe the applications or so for the research area currently, if you are interested to follow this axe?
Now, what is the difference between an application and a network application? Network application is control. It's control and management. So for example, the control of handover, it's an application. But for me, there is no difference between a service and a control application. It's the same kind of software we have. So for me, there is no difference. The cloud has to take care of all the things, control, management, application, and so on. So for me, just cloud and data center is just a lot of machine, a lot of memory, a lot of power, a lot of storage. And we can do a lot of things due to this because we can retrieve large number of information in comparison with what we can do in distributed system, for example. And we have a strong power to have, as I said, I can compute all the time, routing table, switching table, forwarding table. There is no limit of power. This is the definition. But I agree that all has to be defined maybe more precisely in the future.
Thank you. For this nice talk. So, as you know, the configuration of firewalls in the cloud environment is very, very difficult task, since the configuration is usually made by hand, and it may contain many anomalies. Mm-hmm. And another point is how to check whether the configuration is correct with respect to security policy. So have you any comment about
The question is how to virtualize this, because it's really dependent on the user. And if you push this in the cloud, agree that you need to have a good connection between the user and the cloud and this firewall that is not close to the user but outside. So it's clear you need a lot of capacity in the networking. But we think that we have this capacity today. So we are not limited by the capacity of the network because we have a lot of optic fiber. And if we're looking at 4G, 5G now, technology, we're talking about 100 megabit per second in 5G and 4G, and 5G is 1 gigabit per second per terminal. So there is no problem of capacity. And it's why we can have a discussion between the user and the firewall, even if the firewall is in the cloud. And the point is you have much more power in the cloud than in your local firewall machine. And we are just using this power in the cloud. But the configuration still is the same. There's no difference between the policy, the security policy, still is the same. There is no difference with what is existing. The only thing is you have more power. It's all.
The problem, even in a small network, there is a problem how to check whether the configuration is correct with respect to security policy. So for the cloud, the problem will be more huge.
Yeah, but it's the same problem. It's a remote problem, but it's the same problem. So just a problem of capacity of the network.
You say that in general, I think your point of view is that hardware is the best to secure rather than software.
Is.
You say that hardware is in general so is best to secure for security. I think that hardware also has some drawbacks. For example, as you know, many hardware machines are considered as black box, and it may contain some program to spy private networks. And also another thing which is also very important. So, so for hardware, there is now very very powerful techniques to understand. Even if you have microprocessor, there is very efficient technique which allows to have many informations about the key, the length of the key, for the from the consumption, from noise of the microprocessor, and so on. Mm-hmm. So I think that each technique can have some advantages and drawbacks.
I totally agree with you. Okay. No, I said generally, the hardware is, you need a hardware to be well protected. It's more difficult to open a hardware than a software. It's all. Now, you're right. Sometimes it's much better to have software than the hardware for other reason. But it's true that with the power gain of the data centers, as soon as you have a software, the attack is more easy than 10 years ago, and due to the power of the cloud. Look at now, you have hackers with, I don't know, $5. They may have 1 hour of computation with a factor of 3, 4, 5 more than 3, 4 years ago. So they can decrypt a lot of things now. But I agree with you. There is also some drawback on the hardware somewhere, and if you want to have a fortune today, is to have this this virtual SIM card. If you can have this virtual SIM card with the same security, you have billions of dollars immediately, because we're looking for that. But personally, I don't think that we can find a solution. But if you can find a solution to have really in software, the same security as the SIM card, you're really very rich. You have to patent immediately and go to Google, and it will buy this patent for a fortune.
Thank you.
Good morning. I have a question about the virtual SIM card.
Yeah.
You say that the SIM card are stored by Google in the cloud. But this supposes that you are trusting Google, but it happens that Google is facing the most of antitrust procedure in the world.
Absolutely.
So I don't think it's the solution.
Absolutely, I'm totally agree with this. Now, what just to describe what is Google is doing, but I'm against total as you, because I never believe in Google, because. As soon as the government, NSA will ask him the key. He will give the key of all your SIM card. So I definitely agree with you. But I just show what is Google is doing. But I totally agree that we have not to follow this. But okay, we will see what happens. Because of today, for the identity of your identity, there is a big fight between the technology Google, telecom operator, manufacturer with their own embedded SIM card, and maybe a bank also that can arrive with NFC card. So it's really a big fight today. So I have no idea who will succeed in this.
Actually, concerning this point, I saw on a paper written by MIT, I think, that they are thinking about combining hardware security on user equipment and also software for its openness, agility, and also because it allows by time to change the key by time. So having kind of security shared by hardware on one side and software on the other side. What's your opinion concerning this?
Yeah, I agree that there is a trade-off, in fact, between sometimes you have to use hardware, sometimes you have to use software, and if you can have both...
Combine them,
and yeah. I agree that could be a good solution.
So that you'll have your personal security, and in addition, your operator or whatever security. Yeah.
No, I agree. Agree.
I would like to know whether the resource management is handled by the radio technology, such as LTE or MTS, or by the cloud, for both radio and networking resources.
Networking resources, so how to control network resources in MPLS and in SDN technology? That the question?
LTE and UMTS for radio technologies.
For this kind of technology, we are using more and more cloud and the power of data centers. Mm-hmm. Because again, the smartphone has no power to decide by itself the route and things like this. Mm-hmm. That's why we are pushing all this decision to all this control in the cloud. But what is doing the telecom operator is not big cloud in general, but small clouds close from the node B and E node B. Why not to have a cloud led, for example, in a node B? Because you can decide in the node B itself a lot of things. You have big memory, big power, and then decide there what to do. And so to push all the decision that could be in the terminal to have this in the cloudlets. But it's true that if you are looking at the telecom operators that are also developing a big cloud also to take care of other supervision of the network.
And for radio resources?
For?
Radio resources.
Rate?
Radio.
Radio resource, same thing. More and more, could be taking
handled by
a
cloud.
Yeah, by a cloudlet somewhere. So it's really centralization, really. And so the real problem is the real time now. It's why the centralization has to be close from the extremity. So there is something bizarre. In the same time, we centralize, but we need real time. Okay, so the trade-off is a small cloud for me. It's not big cloud, but a small data centers close to the different
equipment.
The node B, for example.
Thank you.
Ask about the question of Mariam about the controller.
Yeah.
The migration of the controller. If we need to migrate all the controller, we will not need to migrate all the controller.
Yeah.
We will need only to migrate the forwarding tables.
Depends. But generally yes, because if you really want to migrate the controller, you have the software of the controller ready. It's a virtual machine, not used, so idle. In the data centers, so the machine is virtual machine is there, so you have not to move the machine itself. You have just to move the routing table, the forwarding table, and say the configuration of the machine.
So finally, we don't need to centralize all the things. We don't need a centralized controller. Since we will move the forwarding tables, we will not need a centralized equipment.
Because you need at some point to have computation to compute the routing tables, and then to compute this routing table, you need all the information of the network. So the center has a total view of the network, So when you move the controller, you have to move all this information. Because if your network is, I don't know, 1 million nodes, you have to move this information, this 1 million node, from one controller to another one. And this is impossible. And so why is this solution is good for me for small networks? For example, if we're looking again at Google decided to go in the SDN technology, and they bought Nisira technology, so OpenFlow technology, but they have only 25 nodes. So you can move the information of the 25 nodes. It's 1 million nodes. It's not possible to move the controller in that case.
So it's more better to use MPLS solutions, which are distributed, the solution of separation between the control and the forwarding plane, than using the OpenFlow solution.
Yeah, absolutely. You can do exactly the same thing with MPLS. You're right. Okay. You move all the control of MPLS in the central point. Absolutely.
And I have another question about network virtualization function. Mm-hmm. You speak about moving the router. You said that when moving a router, we will change the routing table. Mm-hmm. I thought that the idea about cloud computing is that we will never change anything when the application is running, so that we will not see an interruption of the application.
Yeah.
So if we will change the routing table, mm-hmm. that means that will be a discovery, a new discovery of the network resources, and mm-hmm. a change of the routing table. Mm-hmm. I thought that it will be only a migration of the forwarding plane, mm-hmm. and not a change of the.
Yeah, but after it depends how you are moving the machine. So it depends if you are. Before to remove the first router, you can open the other one, and still the first one is working. And just at one point, you decided that the flow, instead to go to that router, go to the other one. So in fact, when I say I'm moving the router, in fact, I let the first router where he is, he continue to work, and I open the other one at the same time, so that the both can work in together at the same time. And I remove the other one, and automatically the routing table is the new routing. So there is no interruption of the traffic.
It will be a problem of IP address
assignment. Sure. I agree.
I propose that you follow this discussion later, because actually it's much, much, much more complex.
Yeah.
As Guy explained,
yeah.
You have many dimensions, and you need to move what is necessary to be able to route to your. That as in usual distributed systems, actually. So this discussion is very interesting, but
yeah.
you can continue on later on. Sorry. Maybe another question. I would have a question concerning the perpetual cycle of centralizing, distributing, mm-hmm. and it's true that for the moment we are in the stage of centralizing.
Absolutely.
Because there is some problematics to deal with, which are very interesting. But however, thinking about the migration and the distribution later on, when we centralize, we'll have a centralized control. And as we need to be on time for some obvious, for some obvious reasons, such as control, configuration management, managing the catalog of the different functions and whatever, how can you imagine later to have the management of this global control? I mean, know what they need to have kind of consensual decision to know which one will migrate with what to do what and whatever. You know.
For the decision itself, if you have all the information in one point, it's much easier to
right.
take a decision that in a distributed way. But now you're right; all the problem is real time. If you want to control a flow of 1 gigabit per second, if you need 10 milliseconds to decide something to a center, you lose a lot of the throughput. Right. So it's clear that we come back to all the drawback of a centralized system. Right. Real time, you need to duplicate the center. What is the good center at one time? So there is a lot of problem today. But why we are doing that? Only because we have this strong power and this huge storage in some point today. And the Google, Microsoft, Amazon, and so on are pushing us to go in that direction. I'm not sure it's a good direction again. It's maybe more economical solution to push people to have new, to buy new things. I'm not sure it's working better than before. Mm-hmm. That's the problem of technology, economic, politics, and
so on.
Again, that's a new direction. I don't know, I have no idea why, because this direction was pushed by this small company, Nicira, bought by VMware, again, $1.2 billion, to change the things. I'm not sure it's better than before, but it's true that we have this power in data centers, and this permit to do new things and compute one routing table per user, have one network per user eventually, things like this. So it's something new, so we're going in that direction. But there is the same drawback as centralization.
And maybe more later.
Maybe more. Yeah. It's why we will distribute all the things as soon as possible.
Sure. Okay, thank you. Let's thank
you.
Warmly, Professor.